Welcome to Ageism in the Culture of Perpetual Adolescence. I hope you kids are leaning in. All my former students, beloved, as well as anyone else who's passing by. William Shatner, Captain Kirk, turned 90 a couple months ago, and I read an interview recently of his. Apparently, the only thing he's done distinguishing is to ride and or tame aggressive horses. There's a specific name for them. I'll put it in the captions because I can't recall it being not a young person. But he has been keeping his body toned, probably every muscle in it, by doing this, including his brain. I don't know what his nutrition is like. I don't know what he eats every day, but I'm certain that that is a factor as well, along with good genes. He's an anomaly, you might say. However, my father was very similar, minus the skin tone and muscle system, because my father was a marathon runner. He didn't train wild animals on their backs, but he did move his body every day until he could no longer get out of the chair by himself. And that, I think, was around the age of 92 or 3. Up until that point, he was standing in the kitchen giving haircuts under the fluorescent light in his barber coat on the wheelie chair that he'd set up in the middle of the floor for his final six loyals from a cast of thousands. And the only thing that took his life was pneumonia, which he contracted in the nursing home. No surprises there, right? That was Dad. Now, what really provoked this discourse was the PGA Golf Classic. Phil Mickelson, 6 or 7 days shy of his 51st birthday, won that game hands down. And not by a wing and a prayer. He won it. Which is considered extraordinary in the world of sport. At least mainstream sport. I'm sure William Shatner would have something to say about off the beaten path sport. Age. A culture of perpetual adolescence. Has been, in a word, sidelined. Unlike Far Eastern cultures, wherein the older you get chronologically, the more you are revered by all. That'll never happen in the United States, will it? And some of us aren't asking for it. We're just wistful. Because the state of perpetual adolescence has its pros and cons. What is the character of an adolescent? The first thing that comes to my mind as a retired public school educator is energy. Largely hormone driven, but energy nonetheless. Propelling energy. The next adjective might be enthusiasm. A healthy adolescent, as opposed to one steeped in, say, for example, addiction, which is tragic, a healthy adolescent will have enthusiastic energy toward one or many pursuits. Infectious, enthusiastic energy. Self-perpetuating. seemingly unsquelchable. The adolescent is hopeful, if oblivious, and hopefully spared early onset tragedies, which ultimately will shape character. So let's onion skin the adolescent mentality into a culture such as the United States. We are that perpetually adolescent culture. Energy, enthusiasm, hormonally driven, oblivious of history and the importance of what we learn from it. Those who've lived longer than just the past 2 years of the latest technological advance, who've endured toil, the passage of time, quote unquote, which is actually a misnomer if you ask any scientist, time doesn't pass. But we live through it. We have known toil, effort, commitment to an amount of time required to accomplish a major task. The age of technology, the technological revolution, has precluded that experience in the mind of the adolescent. Is preclude the word I'm looking for? Let's try prevent. Do adolescents comprehend what has laid groundwork upon which they enjoy day-to-day living and thriving? That's where we were, and those who preceded us, setting it up for the next generation. But let's talk about ageism, which is to label somebody of a certain age as being finished, as having lived out their productive value in a society, assumably because their discs are full and there's nothing new that can be contributed by somebody who has outlived their relevance. Ask William Shatner. Ask Phil Mickelson. Ask me. I didn't begin to play serious professional performance piano until the age of 33. My cello professor was convinced that one could not learn anything new late in life, and that late starters didn't have much of a prayer. I have enjoyed a lifetime of professional performance piano on the stages of the likes of the Cleveland Orchestra in Severance Hall, where I played the Steinway for the Koyo Young Artists Concerto Competition as an accompanist. I was well over 40 at the time. I was over 50 at the time. I wouldn't have imagined myself having that opportunity at the age of 24. It came to me 25 years later. So that's just my drop in that bucket. I'm a late starter, and I made up for a lot of lost time. And it wasn't lost time. That time was enriched by experience. Plus, scientific advancements have proved that when you are learning a new task never before attempted, it does not matter your chronological age. New blood vessels will form in your brain, and new brain cells, which is the essence of learning. And apart from taking a little more time as a chronologically older adult, any new task is possible. We're not wasted, and we're not waste products. America. So lean in. Show some respect. Show some genuine interest in dispensing with the chronological age of anything and anybody. This country has been an adolescent for way too long. It's time to grow up.